Hello and welcome to Heroes and Patriots. This program is about national security, intelligence, and foreign policy. Today is Thursday, March 2nd, 2023, and we are streaming live from the studios of KMUD Community Radio in Northern California. I'm Mary Massey here with co-host John Sakowitz. Hi, John.
Hey, Mary, and good morning to our listening audience here in Northern California and listening to the web stream throughout the world. Thank you for joining us.
We invite listeners to call in with questions for our guests today, and we have two. The number to call, 707-923-3911. So as we begin the second year of the war in Ukraine, we are going to be talking a lot about NATO and its role in this effort. In our first segment, John and I will be speaking with Dr. Jan Åberg. Professor Åberg is joining us from Sweden to discuss NATO's Sweden and Finland campaign. Dr. Åberg is the co-founder of the Swedish-based Transnational Foundation for Peace and Future Research. Professor Åberg has done extensive work on NATO and the roots of conflict. We now welcome Professor Åberg to the program. Good morning, or good evening in your case.
Good evening, good morning. Pleased to be with you.
Very good. Well, we are very delighted that you've joined us for the next 30 minutes. And I wondered if you might tell our listeners a little bit about when the foundation was begun and its mission, just so we can get a little background of what you're about.
Okay, yes. We're a totally independent and truly independent research foundation, a private one, only financed by people, not by governments or corporations. And our goal has been since 1986 to deliver public education based on research in favor of or promoting the article number one in the UN Charter that says that peace shall be established by peaceful means. And the whole charter is about trying everything by civilian means before you, according to Chapter 7 of the Charter, go into possible military action. Mm-hmm. So that's what we're committed to. My own background is sociology and peace and conflict research since the 70s. The whole thing we do is to come up with proposals, do analysis that can help people anywhere who are interested in reducing all kinds of violence. That's what it is about. You may say it's Gandhian, but we are not Gandhians, but you see what I mean.
Sure. And as we look at the second year, the beginning of the war, and it's very militarily led and not much that we know of behind the scenes peacemaking, how would you react to how NATO's role has been so far in this skirmish?
You mean particularly concerning Ukraine?
Correct.
Okay, yes. Let me say, I deviate from those who think this is a Russian-Ukraine conflict. It is a Russia-NATO conflict that plays out cynically by both parties on Ukraine's territory. NATO has expanded against all well-documented promises to Mikhail Gorbachev 30 years ago from all major leaders in the West. They have expanded against the promises of not doing so, provided they got the unified Germany into NATO, and that they did. Since then, 10 countries have become members of NATO. And while Russia might say, well, we don't care too much about Montenegro or Croatia becoming NATO members, they have always said that Ukraine is the reddest of red lines. Everybody in the West who knows anything about realpolitik, knows something about history, and knows something about Russia, thinking, have also warned from George Kennan, who was, if you will, the grand architect of the Cold War, to, funnily enough, the present CIA director, William Burns, who was the ambassador to Moscow. And he wrote to Condoleezza Rice that he had yet to find one person who would not see it as extremely provocative in Moscow if NATO even tried to get Ukraine into NATO. My point is very simple, and I've written about a 150-page book about it, is that nobody listened in Brussels. We were so much stronger, as you know, Russian military expenditures are about 8% before the rearmament now started of NATO's military expenditures. It had been on its knees because it fell apart. And so you could basically do whatever you please, or so you thought, without thinking of the fact that Russia might come back at some point on its feet again and say, what on earth are you doing? Putin and everybody else, all the presidents, have done two fascinating things. They have argued that they wanted Russia to become members of NATO, and got a no. Listen carefully to what I say. They have all wanted to become members of NATO and got a no. And secondly, they have all said, Ukraine must find other solutions, such as some kind of guarded neutrality or whatever. It cannot become a member of NATO. I fully support that state. I do not support the invasion, but I support the fact that there are limits to how far you can expand NATO without getting into trouble. And that is what must now be hidden from the audiences in the West, that NATO has made its largest blunder by being 30 years training, participating in the civil war, giving Ukraine arms, and now cynically using Ukraine to finally crush Russia, which, of course, they won't be able to do.
John?
Yes, thank you for being on the show, Jan, and thank you for calling in from Sweden. Last month, I attended the book launch of Richard Haass's new book, The Bill of Obligations, about citizenship. And Richard, as you know, is the president of the Council on Foreign Relations, and he will be retiring this year, no doubt. And sort of his swan song here is thinking about citizenship. And he was thinking mainly about what it means to be an American citizen. But since this is an international call, and you're an international expert on war, I wanted you to think about what it means to be a global citizen. How would you define global citizenship, and what is that particular Bill of Responsibilities all about?
Well, I think we have a kind of global citizenship in the sense that many people individually feel and are engaged in issues which goes far beyond their own nation state and borders. Of course, in the global citizen thinking, that's what humanity is about. It is to not only say, everything important, whatever the cost for my own country, but looking at a more, macro perspective in time and space on what is the best for humanity. We're all part of a humanity, but we're not all part of the same nation state. That goes back to the 1648 and the Peace of Westphalia. So there are lots of things we can do. We call ourselves transnational because we believe in individual human security connected to global and humanity security, but we do not believe in national military security and deterrence and nuclear weapons. And you can say that's a belief or not a belief, but we've so far proven right. That does not create peace for anybody in the world. The world's largest, most important, strongest, most costly alliance, NATO, is now involved in what could very well become a nuclear war. It's a total fiasco for the promise of making peace.
That brings me to my next question. You've written that we're now in the very dangerous territory, perhaps brought to that point by NATO, of a combination.
Not only, but also.
But also. A combination of intellectual and moral disarmament combined with military rearmament. What is intellectual and moral disarmament, and how does that play into military rearmament?
Well, of course, this is my personal formulation. It's not a scientific term. I've been in this business for more than 45 years, since I was a young student in the 70s. I knew politicians in the West. I knew politicians very well in Sweden and Denmark. I sat in the Danish government's commission for 10 years on disarmament and security. I've been a consultant to a number of countries. I've done studies in about 20 conflicts around the world and helped people to understand how they could get out of it if they stopped warfare. Now, what I can see over these years is that those who make decisions today are speaking like, Twitter statements about things instead of having solid knowledge. The people who used, like me, to be consulted and write papers for the ministries of foreign affairs have been replaced by people who do marketing and tell politicians what kind of ties to put on and things like that, you know. Let me give you an example. The Swedish Prime Minister at the time, Magdalena Andersson, came out after Sweden had decided in its parliament to send a membership application. She said the following, I'm quoting directly. There are many things we Swedes can disagree about, but there's one thing we do agree about, and that is that we love Sweden. And loving Sweden means it must be defended, and is now going to be defended in NATO. You know, that statement by a prime minister right. tells me that there's no intellectualism behind it. It's populist nonsense. This is not what it's about. So the long story short is this intellectual moral disarmament, of course, has to do with the fact that people don't know basic theories of what they deal with, be it deterrence, be it common security, be it diplomacy, which basically has disappeared. I mean, we don't have any diplomacy with the Russians anymore. We've cut off everything. Only people who don't know anything about conflict resolution and do not want peace cut off connections with the other side.
We've done that
through Europe.
Professor, we have a caller on this topic. Caller, if you're listening, go ahead with your question.
Yes, great. Sorry, I have some difficulty hearing you. I just wanted to say, Professor Oberg, Dr. Oberg, this is a very important call. Foreign policy by tweet is where I fully agree with you. And I'm wondering if you could talk about, in a different perspective, that the people who are in power now are missing the Cold War, and that this is what they are familiar with. It's very complicated to deal with the fall of the Berlin Wall. They're still in that peace era, and I'm just potential for peace era. I'm just wondering if you could talk about how to find the new generation of leaders who will be more cosmopolitan and more transnational, and try to get us out of this populist Cold War perspective.
Thank you, caller, Professor.
Well, I wish I had an intelligent answer to how to find these people. I think if you ask me, I would say honestly, I think everything has gotten to get worse before it gets better. It's a terrible statement. I would never have thought that I should say that about the Western world, but that's what I see. Also, for two reasons, the leaders at the moment, and probably the future, hopefully the future leaders too, but those at the moment, are different from the earlier leaders we had in Europe, because the earlier leaders, be it Willy Brandt or Bruno Kreisky, Olof Palme or Urho Kekkonen or whoever you took, they knew what war was. They were children of the Second World War, or later on they had parents who knew what the Second World War was. Now, we do not have this kind of fear of war anymore in Europe. We are hearing politicians say and take steps that are just like the chicken game, you know. You know what that is in the US, and it means who will blink first, right?
Right.
The other thing is, I believe that the West and all the situation we're in now can be related to the fact that what we call the Western world, the Western hemisphere, the United States, NATO, and EU are on their way down in a macro perspective. The rest of the world is on its way up. Of course, everybody thinks of China, but it's not going to be an empire like we have been. But there's a huge, gigantic change going on in the world order. And what the West is best at, and what the US in particular has the strongest power and is still second to none in, is the military. It's not the economy. It's not culture. It's not social respectability. It's not legitimacy vis-a-vis international law, but it's the military. So where you know you're relatively, comparatively strongest, that's what you use. And that is now crushing peace research institutes. It's crushing diplomacy. It's crushing common security thinking. It is getting into hubris where you can do whatever you please because you are strongest. That is very, very dangerous. There has to be modesty. There has to be empathy. The basic of diplomacy is empathy, trying to understand what the other side is saying and listen to it, no matter whether you disagree or like or not. That's not the point. We have to live together on this globe. That's another global citizenship thinking. We have to live together in unity and diversity. And that's what these people do not have an intellect or even a moral standard to practice, where people like Blinken and others who are just talking about, you know, inventing things like China is now going to arm Russia to kill people in Ukraine. I mean, this is appalling to just hear it.
Yeah. Professor, I'd like to bring the conversation back to Sweden and Finland, possibly,
yes,
or in all likelihood, joining NATO. And the role that disinformation, propaganda, and false news plays. As one example, you've written about Sweden's single worst security challenge was the Russian submarine U-137 Whiskey on the Rocks. It was a Russian submarine, but more truly, it was an American psychological operation conducted by something known as navigation expert on board, who was never interviewed in Sweden and who soon disappeared. And this raised a lot of panic in Sweden, and it just plays into the whole rule, strategy that false news and propaganda plays. Yeah, even in decisions like Sweden and Finland joining NATO. Please talk about the role of propaganda, false news, and disinformation.
Well, there are several things here. Let me try to see whether I can catch them one by one. First of all, what you refer to is an analysis made by a research colleague of mine whose name is Ola Tunander. I have not made that, not written that book or done that analysis. He spent 20 years of his life trying to understand what happened. And that, of course, is very difficult to prove, but it's part of something bigger, namely that since the murder of Prime Minister Olof Palme, there has been a systematic change, a step-by-step tyranny, if you will, from neutrality status, which was, of course, you know, Sweden always knew that it was closer to the West because of the way we live and things like that, but still a formal neutrality status where people like Olof Palme could go into the world's conflicts and be a mediator, as he was between Iran and Iraq. Amazing for a prime minister to do that. That type of thing is over for long ago. But there has been host nation support agreements. There has been a Swedish political backup behind all the U.S. wars from Iraq and onwards. And so this last, you know, initiative to make Sweden a member of NATO is not that surprising. What surprised me, and that's not much that surprises me any longer, was the speed with which it took place, the total uniform pro-NATO media coverage, the national television, public service television, which had 20 experts for NATO membership and one from a peace movement who were against it. And of course, not people like me. Anybody who were participated in these programs up to the decision making were people who were pro-NATO. And so you can say what is fake, what is omission, what is this and that. What we see is there's no decent democratic process in this. Sweden sent this application for NATO membership when public opinion polls stated or showed that 47% of the Swedish people were pro-NATO membership, which had gone up just a little because the Swedish people have a huge problem with nuclear weapons, which we decided long ago not to have.
Right.
And secondly, if you ask me, you should have had a referendum. But none of the new countries in NATO, the 10 new members, have ever had a referendum. So that's not that's not that much democracy. And may I say in parentheses, there is not a single opinion poll ever made in Ukraine that proved that the Ukrainian people wanted NATO membership. That was a tiny minority. And then Stoltenberg says in NATO that we always follow the democratic choice of people. It was made by two presidents and not at all by the Ukrainian people. Now they want it, but that's a different situation. So right. What I'm saying is this has gone way too fast. And if you want a membership, it should be backed up by at least 75% of the people, which it basically is in Finland, but not in Sweden. Let me add one more appalling thing. That is that on the third day of the new prime minister's role as prime minister, Mr. Christensen, he went down to have a press conference with Mr. Stoltenberg in Brussels, NATO's secretary general, at which he said the following: Sweden will live up to all its obligations in NATO, including NATO's nuclear doctrine. He had no mandate to say that. from anywhere, and there are lots of countries in NATO who are not behind the nuclear doctrine of NATO. So this is shameful, and the shameful thing is no media is asking, what on earth did he just say?
Yeah.
Right. So, continuing with that thought, you know, the role that the media plays, you know, we've talked about false news and disinformation propaganda, but the media is also, as it is in the United States, the media is also a key component in the military industrial media academic complex, not just here in the United States, but in your country as well. And power elites on both sides of the world decide security and foreign policy matters. Discuss the role of power elites and how they pretty much preclude very little public discussion and public democratic decision making.
Yeah, I think that's what we've been seeing around these issues. The more you can make people believe that the war is around the corner, you can make people accept whatever. It's the same with the terrorism thing. The moment you can make people fear, you can make them do whatever you want them to do. And therefore, war and militarism is one very effective. That's also why we basically don't have a peace movement. We have lots of individuals, but and we have people who protest war, but that's not the same as peace. Peace research at various institutes has disappeared long ago. The peace discourse has been disappeared also from the media. I haven't heard for years a journalist here in Scandinavia ask, what is that, good or not good for peace? Everybody talks about security, and everybody knows that security is military, it's not peace. So you can go on like the paradigm of thinking alternatively to power elites has disappeared completely, and that is damn dangerous. I can put it very, very squarely, militarism is incompatible with democracy.
Right. We have about five more minutes with you. I wondered if you might share if there is anyone in the United States who has been working towards the end of diplomacy rather than a military, you know, conclusion or solution, rather. Could you help us out and understand if there's an entity or a person who's really working, say, in tandem with you and your efforts?
Oh, we have a couple of Americans working with us, such as Professor Richard Falk, retired long ago from Princeton University. We've had David Trieger at the Nuclear Age Peace Foundation in California. That's not the problem. You have tons of intelligent, well-oriented, well-informed, visionary thinkers, both at that side of the Atlantic and over here. They just don't have any impact because nobody's asking them about anything. So that's easy to answer that question. What I think is that part of the intellectual decay or intellectual disarmament, that the people who know something are not used. You have Jeffrey Sachs, for instance. He's used, but he's now no longer used by the mainstream media. He's sitting on alternative media. I think that's great, and he's doing a great work. Great job. You have Chomsky or whatever. But they are not part of the mainstream discussion. They are not let in, and that's another dimension of intellectual disarmament. If they were let in and were contrasted with decision makers, it would be very embarrassing for the average decision maker who doesn't know anything.
Right. So let's focus people to your work and how they might follow your work. Excuse me. Transnational Foundation for Peace and Future Research. How can folks read about it, read your articles, and so forth?
That's very simple. We have one of the largest peace research, peace public education sites anywhere in the world with some 8,000-9,000 articles over almost 40 years, and that's on transnational.live. It's as simple as that, transnational.live, which is one homepage, and we have another one which we call TFF2, and TFF is the Transnational Foundation for Peace and Future Research. And then we have a mail service, and we're all over the place in social media. So given that we have a shoestring budget, We're all volunteers, all 50 people around the world who are associated with us are all volunteers. We are having a terrific, outreach compared with state institutes who are only doing what they should do and know that they should abstain from doing.
Professor, final question, and perhaps it's my most important question. Assuming that Finland and Sweden do join NATO, would putting nuclear weapons in Finland and Sweden be a violation of the non-proliferation treaty?
I would think yes, but if the Swedish Prime Minister goes and says, you know, we live up to the nuclear doctrine, follow the obligations of the nuclear doctrine of NATO too, the race is run. It doesn't matter to him whether it's compatible with international law or Swedish traditions or anything like that. Secondly, you know, I'm not so afraid perhaps in the short run that there would be nuclear weapons in Swedish territory, but what I think there will be is American weapons like they're now planning in Denmark and have already installed in Norway, which militates against everything Denmark has been saying since 49 as a founding member of NATO. We do not want foreign troops. We do not want prepositioning of materiel. We do not want nuclear weapons, and we do not participate in NATO's nuclear planning group. Now, In the last foreign policy declaration of the Swedish government, they goddamn have the guts to say that, like Denmark and Norway, we enter NATO without any preconditions. I mean, these other neighboring countries have had these exceptions from in their membership since 49, and the Swedish foreign administration has not noticed this. I'm appalled. What I think is much worse, Sweden will not be able to do mediation. Sweden will not be able to work seriously against nuclear weapons and disarmament and abolition. Not that it has done it very efficiently, but it had, in Palmer's days, it had that idea. It will not be able to think up a foreign policy, formulate an independent policy. You will have to follow U.S. foreign policy when you're a NATO member. There's no, but you have to be Switzerland or Austria or Sweden or something else if you're doing otherwise, because there is no example that, for instance, Denmark or Norway has deviated completely from what was the ideas, the wars, the strategies, the doctrines of the United States. That is the leader of NATO. So you can actually pack up your Ministry of Foreign or Defense and say, we follow whatever they are doing over there. And that, to me, is totally shameful, because Sweden has been a hope for the whole world. It was a small country that had a different, independently formulated, research-based policy in the days of Olof Palme. I happen to know him a little bit at the time. And there was a wish to do good for the rest of the world's smaller countries and take the fight against the Vietnam War, the U.S. and Vietnam. Now, things like that are totally dead by now. There's no way that you should expect Sweden to do anything like that in the future. And that makes me very sad. But it also increases the risk of war in our area.
Well, we will certainly be watching what you're doing. And we so appreciate your perspective and what you offer here. We've been speaking with Professor Jan Åberg, who is based in Sweden, with the Transnational Foundation for Peace and Future Research. And we would love to have you back on as things develop, not just with Ukraine and Russia, but as with NATO as well, just in general. So we do hope you'll come back and be with us again.
Just call me.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for your important work.
Thank you so much for what you do.
Thank you.
We need each other.
Yes, we do.
Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Community Radio, Heroes and Patriots, second part of the second interview of the show in a second.
Welcome back to Heroes and Patriots, a program about national security, intelligence, and foreign policy. It is 31 minutes past the hour, and we are coming to you live from the studios of KMUD Community Radio in Northern California. I want to remind our listeners that you can speak to our guests, and in a minute we will be speaking with Professor David Gibbs. But that number to call with questions is 707-923-3911. We'd love to hear your comments and thoughts as we continue our discussion on NATO. David N. Gibbs is a professor of history at the University of Arizona. He, I'm looking for your MIT, there we go. He received his PhD from MIT in 1989, his master's from Georgetown University in political science, government, and his BA in political science at George Washington University. He's written many, many books. Well, no, I'm just trying to find our screen.
It's the 1 year anniversary of the war in the Ukraine.
I'm not sure.
And Professor David Gibbs is one of the country's strongest authorities on NATO.
There
and,
I am.
And how NATO just played into this war. We just finished having an international call with Professor Jan Oberg about Finland and Sweden joining NATO. But NATO is the conflict. You know, Professor Oberg talks about the difference between conflict and war and how conflict has to underlie war. It's one of the causes. It is the cause of war. And NATO is the cause of this war. So on this 1 year anniversary, we are delighted to have Professor David Gibbs.
Professor Gibbs, are you with us? Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for having me on.
Yeah, sorry for the flubbing on your intro there. I thought I had lost Zoom, so I was a little panicked that I lost you. So I think you heard John's introduction, and we are delighted to have you for the next 30 minutes to continue our discussion. You know, a year ago, February 2022, you wrote about NATO's expansion into Eastern Europe, that it never had anything to do with security in any meaningful sense. Could we start there, please?
Sure. I think the issue was that when the Cold War was over, most people would say it ended in November 1989 with the collapse of the Berlin Wall.
Right.
When the Cold War was over, NATO really ceased to have any function. NATO's function officially was to deter or repel a Soviet invasion of Eastern Europe, of Western Europe, I should say. And by the end of 1989, that was considered an impossibility. And the Warsaw Pact, the Soviet-led counterpart to NATO, was collapsing and did collapse in 1990. And everyone assumed, I think there was a widespread assumption, NATO would simply disintegrate because it had no function. But I think in the leading power centers in Washington, there was a real effort by a group of neoconservatives led by Paul Wolfowitz at the Pentagon and strongly supported by Richard Cheney, then Defense Secretary of the United States, and to basically find some new function for NATO. And one of the functions they proposed was that NATO should not go out of business, but should expand into the former communist states in Eastern Europe. And it identified potential enemies, including post-Soviet Russia. It became post-Soviet Russia at the end of 1991. And China were identified as potential enemies of the United States and potential enemies of NATO. And I think the idea was that with the collapse of the Soviet Union, the United States was presented with a unique opportunity in history, which was to set up a sort of unipolar global dominance with no peer rivals at all, and to achieve a kind of global dominance by American power. And the U.S. should welcome and secure this opportunity by trenching militarily, but by expanding militarily. And NATO was seen as one of the major ways of achieving that, of expansion of U.S. power. It was a very aggressive document that was issued in 1992 called the Defense Planning Guidance Document that laid out this overarching strategy. And I would say that became the main strategy of using NATO basically as an almost an offensive weapon to spread American power globally and maintain it as long as possible, and to do it to some degree at other countries' expense. I should add this was heavily backed by private sector interests, notably military contractors, who were not looking forward to the idea of reduced demand for their products. And so there was a large domestic constituency for this objective. And I think that really is the origin of the problem, because you see, the United States had made a promise to the then Soviet leader Gorbachev not to expand NATO. We have the documents on this, by the way. People who are interested can find the documentation at the website of the National Security Archive of George Washington University. There really is no doubt the United States made what was essentially an agreement with the Soviet Union and then violated the agreement by expanding NATO in spite of the promise not to. And I think that really is the origin of the current war, the expansion of NATO against the agreement that the United States had made with Russia not to do so. That really is the beginning of the war here.
Yeah, Professor Gibbs, you mentioned correctly the role of people like Donald Rumsfeld and Paul Wolfowitz. There is something that many of our listeners don't know about, many of Americans don't know about, is one of those shadowy, highly militaristic, for lack of a better word, I'll call it a think tank, but it really is a private club of kind of the private club of the military-industrial complex that was started, I want to say, in 1997, the Project for a New American Century. Many Americans don't know about that, but, you know, they were behind the war in Iraq, which was illegal, immoral, and based on false intelligence. This whole neo-Reaganite foreign policy led to Afghanistan, and here we are in the Ukraine. What was the Project for the New American Century?
Well, this was essentially a lobby group set up in the late 70s that was closely associated with neoconservative figures like Paul Wolfowitz. And, it basically lamented the fact that you were not getting adequate increases in U.S. military spending. U.S. military spending in the 90s was mostly flat. It didn't increase year to year. I mean, it increased to compensate for inflation, but it didn't increase in real terms. And there was a lot of frustration in the military-industrial complex about that fact. They wanted a much more robust expansion of military spending. And the Project for the New American Century was essentially a kind of lobby group that lobbied for increased military spending. And it laid out an extended program of substantially increasing military spending and increasing America's military presence abroad, calling for greater U.S. military presence in the Persian Gulf, as well as in the Caspian Sea region, especially in areas with a lot of oil and hydrocarbon resources, as those two regions have. And, it basically indicated that a basic problem, a limitation, was that the public was not ready for increased military expenditures. The public wanted the government to spend on, shall we say, butter rather than guns, whereas the Project for the New American Century wanted guns over butter. And I think they got lucky, and they got lucky in the sense that, in the first place, George W. Bush was elected and appointed many of these neoconservatives to key positions, most notably Wolfowitz, and, of course, Richard Cheney, who was vice president. And they also got lucky in the sense that you had the 9/11 terrorist attacks, which gave an ideal justification for implementing this program, which they did. And I think for a long time, people got used to the idea that the neoconservatives were mostly Republicans. Many of them, by the way, started out as Democrats, but they became Republicans. Paul Wolfowitz, for example, was a Democrat, became a Republican. But I think a real change occurred during Obama's administration when he brought Hillary Clinton into the State Department. It seems that she was a closet admirer of the neoconservatives and sort of began to, and this was reported in the New York Times, she began courting them while she was Secretary of State under Obama and brought some of them into the State Department, most notably Victoria Nuland, who had previously been National Security Advisor to Vice President Richard Cheney. She became Assistant Secretary of State under Clinton, Assistant Secretary of State, I believe, for Eurasia, and played a major role in U.S. policy towards Russia and Ukraine. At present, she's now Under Secretary of State, the number two position in the State Department, again, playing a very important role in U.S. policy with regard to these things. And she provides a direct link and a continuity from the Bush-Cheney presidency on the one hand, to the current Biden administration. And she's been a very important figure in pushing for, I think, not just U.S. aid to Ukraine, but also provocative moves that were likely to provoke the war and that did provoke the war.
I always hesitate to use the word evil, but evil is a word I would use to describe the Project for a New American Century. They set the table for war in the Middle East, and now they continue to have an effect on foreign policy. You know, on the subject of budgetary matters, I look no further than today's front page article in the New York Times about the fading American resolve, perhaps, to spend these insane amounts of money for foreign aid on Ukraine. You talk about money for guns, money for butter. Well, with the $31 trillion national debt, and with us hitting the national debt ceiling in June, and with the Republican led House looking to be as obstructionist as possible and as difficult as possible, the Biden administration, have we really hit the end of the road in the Ukraine? There's no money left. We had trillions to spend in Iraq and Afghanistan and everywhere else. We had trillions to spend on modernizing our nuclear arsenal, but we're broke now, aren't we?
Well, there's always money to spend if the government wants to spend it. And if, you can divert money from social programs, you can increase the national debt, you can increase taxes. There are all sorts of ways this can be funded. But I think you do have a basic trade-off here. And the basic trade-off is guns or butter. And the money spent on Ukraine will not be spent on increasing living standards in this country. We're funding things like pandemic prevention worldwide, promoting things like, again, some people present this as isolationism. It's not isolationist at all. It's a question of spending money on war making versus spending money on things that raise people's living standards, including globally. There are lots of things the U.S. could do globally that they're not doing because there's not enough money for it, like disease prevention, education in rural areas that are hard to reach, improvement of living conditions for women, again, in remote corners of the world. These things could be funded, but they're not as exciting as war and never get anything close to the kind of money we're spending in Ukraine. And so I think that there's always going to be a trade-off. And people, I'm very surprised and it is remarkable the extent to which even the most left-leaning figures of Congress, including Bernie Sanders and the Squad, have gone along with this completely, the war completely and all the funding, without any objection or protest that I can detect. And they're acting as if this will have no impact on people's living standards, but of course it's having an impact and will continue to have an impact. It is no doubt this is going to reduce the possibility for any kind of social change in this country or globally, because, again, the money is being diverted to war-making activities. And so I think that this ultimately will be the Achilles heel, I think, that you are starting to see declining public support for the war, both here and in Europe, because I think people are, at some level, everyone knows this war is coming out of their pocketbooks. And over time, that becomes much less popular as time goes on. And I think you are starting to see a public getting weary of the war, despite all the war rhetoric and the tremendous push for war and the bipartisan nature of this war. The public is starting to move against it gradually, and I think that'll increase over time.
It is 45 minutes after the hour. If you've just joined the program, we are speaking with Professor David Gibbs, who is from the University of Arizona, teaching history. I wanted to circle back to that profound statement that you feel this current conflict is because the U.S. reneged on its agreement with Russia.
Yes.
Is that something that anyone is even talking about in the media? I mean, it seems like that is not being covered. What we see are the bodies and the explosions and all that, but the source of this is not really being talked about, is it?
No, it's not. I'd say basically it's being talked about, shall we say, disingenuously, in the sense that the constant refrain one hears is always an unprovoked war. I Googled that phrase, unprovoked war, and some variations like unprovoked aggression, unprovoked invasion. A few months ago, I did this. I haven't updated it, but a few months ago, I got 1.5 million hits So this is being said again and again and again and again and again. And I think the reason they're saying it so many times, the reason it's being repeated with so much emphasis, is because it was provoked, and everybody knows it. There's no doubt this was a provoked war. I should add, Russia should probably, what they should have done is swallowed hard and accepted the fact that the United States was provoking it, and accepted the humiliation that would come along with not invading. But they had no justification for invading. Even the U.S. provocations do not justify what Russia did. But nevertheless, one does have to ask, why was it necessary for the U.S. to provoke this war? And provocation, the record is very clear in terms of America made a very firm promise not to expand NATO. Not only was it made by the United States, but by British, French, and German officials as well, or at least it was made in their presence. This is all in the record. You can look at it in the National Security Archive. And not only that, but the top figures in foreign policy making, including some who had been very hardline on the Soviet Union during the Cold War, had all repeatedly insisted in the 1990s there was no purpose for NATO intervention. NATO intervention would only provoke Russia and cause conflict, and it does nothing to enhance security. This was made. There were petitions by top figures urging NATO expansion not take place. People like George F. Kennan and Paul Nitzer, some of the architects of the earliest Cold War, they openly said that this is a very dangerous and provocative game the U.S. was playing expanding NATO. This was said repeatedly in the 1990s. There's a retired admiral, Eugene Carroll, who said the same thing. This is something that I've been warned about repeatedly. In fact, I should add, as recently as 2008, William Burns, who's currently the CIA director of the Biden administration, had been U.S. ambassador to Russia, and he sent a cable that was later leaked to WikiLeaks back to headquarters in Washington that was entitled, I believe it was called Niet Means Niet, No Means No, which was that basically he said he talked, all the Russians he's talked to of all political persuasions believe that to admit Ukraine and Georgia into NATO, which had been proposed in that year, 2008, is the reddest of red lines for the Russians, and it would never be tolerated by the Russians. And he emphasized it isn't just Putin who takes this view, but virtually the whole of the Russian elite takes this view. This is something that will definitely cause conflict, was the implication. So I don't think anybody can say the U.S. didn't know what it was doing, because there were so many warnings that this was coming, not just from Putin and Russia, but from many people, including within the government itself, people like William Burns. So I think it's very difficult to look at the record and not conclude this was an intentional provocation. The United States was very deliberately trying to provoke a war with Russia, and they succeeded. It's right to condemn the invasion, but at the same time, we do have to ask, why was it necessary for the U.S. to provoke the invasion, which is exactly what happened.
I like to think of the war in the Ukraine as a proxy war. Do you agree with that statement? And how does China play into it? But also, kind of the side hustle that Israel has with Iran. Recently, Biden seems to have dropped his opposition to Israel going to war against Iran, and if the Ukraine is a proxy war, we could be looking at a world war. True.
There's a very high risk of nuclear war here. Leon Panetta, the former CIA director, said in Politico that intelligence figures, presumably from the CIA that he talked to, put the odds of nuclear war, of the use of nuclear weapons, between 20 and 25%. This was a few months ago. I assume it's even higher now. We could very well be at the very highest level of risk of nuclear war in history. The only one that even comes close, I would say, was the Cuban Missile Crisis. And I would say it could even be higher than the Cuban Missile Crisis, because then U.S. leadership did seem, under Kennedy at least, determined to do what was possible to achieve a negotiated settlement, whereas I'm seeing nothing like that right now. It seems the Biden administration is perfectly willing to play with the future of humanity, really, based on the assumption that it's worth that risk to defeat Russia. There's a very high risk here. I should add, I really don't think the people making policy here are very talented. And I know it's a strong thing to say, but anybody who doesn't believe me should look at the U.S. evacuation from Kabul and how that was done. Look at some of the videos of how it looked. That's not the act of a foreign policy team that has a great deal of talent and ability. So I think that's a big problem here. I think you can see it also in the fact that there's no U.S. strategy. I think Russia does have a strategy. It's a brutal strategy, but they clearly have a very clear sense of what they want to achieve and how to achieve it. As far as I could tell, the United States has no strategy at all. The U.S. has very vague objectives, ranging from what Biden said to, take Putin out and put him on trial for war crimes, to breaking up the Russian Federation. A former retired three-star general suggested that was a possibility, to retaking all of Ukraine, including possibly Crimea. So you're getting these constantly shifting, changing U.S. objectives here in terms of what we want that don't seem to have any consistency. And so far as I can tell, there's no clear sense of how we're supposed to achieve any of these things. And, Russia has 1,500 active nuclear weapons. And there's a very high risk if they were ever faced anything like defeat. There's a very good chance they would use those weapons. And I just don't understand what the thinking is in Washington in terms of how they intend to have a positive outcome, however defined, short of nuclear war. And that gets me very worried because it almost seems as if, the administration is taking almost a fantasy view of what is going on here and living in a fantasy world.
Yeah.
And I can't think of anything more dangerous than that.
You know, we have about 4 or 5 minutes, and I wanted to just have you speak about President Zelensky of Ukraine. He is certainly aware that the U.S. reneged on this back in 1989. Where does he find himself, really? I mean, he's being attacked by Russia. He's coming to the United States for support.
Yeah.
What is your thought on that?
You know, it's very difficult to say, and I'm reluctant to speak at excessive length about Zelensky, because I don't know him personally. I've never met the man, and I'm reluctant to try and, peek inside his brain and figure out what he's thinking.
Yeah.
I would say that the main consideration, he was elected as president as a peace candidate who intended to basically achieve a negotiated settlement with Russia. And I suspect he was under great pressure by the far right in Ukraine and also by the United States not to achieve any peace with Russia and to renege on his campaign promise. That's the impression I have. In terms of where he is now, I think that he's extremely dependent upon Western, especially American support, without which he would simply collapse. He would collapse almost instantly if that support were pulled. And I think he's very much aware of the fact that in order to get that support, he has to constantly show progress and show victories and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think he's facing this very serious problem now that he may be looking at a major defeat, which is in the city of Bakhmut, which has been besieged for months, which Ukraine has made extraordinary efforts to defend and is now on the point of falling. And, if Ukraine starts moving on the defensive and starts losing territory, which I would say is more likely than not at this point, it would be even more difficult to maintain popular support because the public is being told, victory is around the corner. Ukraine will win. Ukraine can win. If we give them just a few more weapons, they can win. And if the facts on the ground start contradicting that, Zelensky could be in very serious trouble. Hence, I think, he has a great need to constantly show progress. And he may be reaching the end of the road with regard to that strategy. And I really don't know what's going to come next. If Russia does start making progress on the battlefield, will the U.S. escalate further? Will the U.S. now try and insert NATO troops directly into the conflict or U.S. airstrikes? We don't know. I do know there's a lot of very dangerous activity that have gone on. It is highly likely the United States was responsible for blowing up the Nord Stream pipeline. The evidence for that is very strong, I would say. And if the U.S. is willing to go to that length, is willing to be that reckless with its policy, I guess the question I have is, who knows how much further they're willing to go?
Right.
Professor Gibbs, your fine book, First Do No Harm, is taught at my alma mater, the Johns Hopkins School of Advanced International Study. And I wanted to conclude this show with perhaps an update of that book, a fill in the blank. First, Do No Harm, the humanitarian intervention and destruction of the Ukraine. How would you update the book?
Well, I think there's two lessons there. One is that we've got, and my book was about Yugoslavia and the wars in Yugoslavia, and what you had there was the rise of a tone of self-righteousness, basically, where people with a very self-righteous tone insisted on American intervention in the Yugoslav conflict without any sort of weighing of the facts. It was based on a moralistic, self-righteous tone. And that led to a needless escalation of the war and an effort to block peaceful settlement of the war, which was possible. And I think it helped sort of lay out a new kind of politics, particularly on the American left. The American left, I think, was converted to a more pro-war stance in the former Yugoslavia, in that it was decided that American intervention, militarism, the military-industrial complex aren't bad things. They're good things because they promote human rights, they promote democracy, you know, they smash dictatorships and things like that. And I think that basically the same narrative is being used now in the United States and Europe to sell this war to the public. And it's very striking how it's particularly the liberal left that seems enthusiastic about this war. The extent you're getting any significant dissent with regard to this war is on the libertarian right. And you can see that in Congress. The votes against appropriations tend to come from people like Thomas Massie, a libertarian Republican from Kentucky, not from people like Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, who supports the war. So I think that entire narrative that got going in Yugoslavia, and it was sort of, that was the proving ground for a new kind of politics, a new kind of rhetoric, which was extremely effective. And so I think that's the major legacy of the Yugoslav wars, is a new language of intervention that appeals to the political left and has been extremely successful in converting the political left to a pro-war position, I'm sorry to say.
Very astute. Yeah. Thank you.
Professor David N. Gibbs, he's been our guest for the last 30 minutes as we weed through this terrible conflict in Ukraine. We want to thank you for being our guest this morning. We do want you to come back
sure.
and be with us again.
Thank you, Professor Gibbs.